literally at age 43 was my youngest patient at the hospice house in upstate New York, where I became a certified music practitioner. Tight skin, almost bleeding over her hands. Taut face, like plastic surgery job gone bad. And these were only the outward signs of the ravages of scleroderma. The morphine wasn't working. She hardly slept. So I approached the charge nurse one day and said, "How about if I play my harp for Kimberly?" The charge nurse said, "Oh no, she's in too much distress for you to go into her room." She was a new charge nurse. I said, "Well, how about if I set up my chair out here in the hallway and play the harp out in the hallway for Kimberly?" Charge nurse thought a bit and she said, "Well, okay, but we're going to check on her and just see how she's doing." So I set up my little portable chair, got out my Irish lap harp, and began playing arpeggios, broken chords, one note at a time, up and down the harp. Soft, low, and loosely metered, which is one way you can work with extreme pain. I saw the charge nurse go by me and do as she said she would do and went into Kimberly's room. And the next thing I heard, "Where's the music coming from?" "Oh, that's our therapeutic musician in the hall. Can she come in? I want to hear it better." So I was invited into Kimberly's room, took my little chair and my lap harp, did my usual protocol of introducing myself and making sure the music was okay. And I sat down next to Kimberly, where I could see the reactions that I couldn't see in the hall. A furrowed brow, a tick under the chin, restless hands or feet, sighing, moaning, tears, a clenched jaw. But now at last, in the room, I could see her. I began playing, instead of loosely metered random music, I began playing an Irish air called South Wind. Perhaps you know it. Beautiful sweeping chords. And three-quarter time music, not 4-4, to help that would make the heart beat with the rhythm. And I continued playing the sweeping melody. And then I heard another voice. "I've never heard anything like that before. I've never felt like this before." So I continued my playing of these beautiful Irish airs, a little bit slower than perhaps usual, and I saw the hands relax beside her. I saw her eyes begin to flutter, and finally she fell into a badly needed, beautiful, restful sleep. I quietly left the room, and from then on, Kimberly called me her sleeping girl. And the nurse and the charge nurse nicknamed me the musical Morphine, which happens to be the title of my first book. I'm Robin Russell Gaiser. I'm a certified music practitioner, CMP for short. I took a 2.5-year program post-retirement from counseling and teaching and became a therapeutic musician through Music for Healing and Transition Program, a board standard certified organization with classes all over the United States. I began my internship of 6 months at the hospice where I met Kimberly. I did a clinical practicum in the Berkshire Medical Center, and I read a lot of books and did a lot of reports. I want to make it clear that I am not a music therapist. Music therapists have at least 4 years of college degree in music therapy, and they are licensed in states in which they practice. Music therapists, unlike me, also work mostly from prescription. I work in the moment. For instance, 2 weeks ago, I was called to the lodges down in Mills River to go for a dying patient of age 96. I didn't know her, I didn't know her state, so I went and met the music in the moment. Other times I will go to hospice or a hospital and say, are there special needs today? And they'll say, room 212. And so that's what I do. I play and sing. I'm a multi-instrumentalist for critically and chronically ill, elderly, and dying patients. Music is pure vibration. Sound is vibration. It affects the body inside and out. And not only the body, the mind, and the spirit. You probably already have experienced that. For instance, the skin, which is the largest organ in the body, is just peppered with nerve receptors, receiving sound and vibration from music or other events. Has your skin crawled sometimes when you've heard unpleasant things? Have you gotten chill bumps when beautiful things occur and your skin reacts? So we have the skin. And then we have the body, the fluid. We are 70% fluid. And the organs and the bones and the body all receive this vibration coming in. We also have the vagus nerve up here behind your ear, which is the largest nerve cluster in the body. And interestingly enough, all the nerve endings from the vagus nerve go into every organ system in the body. I think it's no accident that the vagus nerve is right here near the ear. And then, of course, there's the brain and the music coming in through the ear, which is fluid, skin, bone, goes to the brain, and the brain translates that into meaning and memory. Now, I'm not going to go into the neuroscience of it all, but I refer you to a book by Dr. Daniel Levitin, L-E-V-I-T-I-N, called This Is Your Brain on Music. It is a wonderful treatise. It's from both a musicology standpoint and also from a neuroscience standpoint, with lots of good, juicy research and lots of great stories. So here we have the body. Now, the vibration, the pure vibration of the music, the slower the music, the lower the music, the slower the vibration. The higher or faster the music, the faster the vibration. And generally speaking, the lower and slower music is the relax, relief, calm down, sleep music. The high pitched, the fast vibrations are the rev up and energize. And we pay attention to that a lot when we are certified music practitioners. There are other elements of music, which I won't go into in detail tonight, but rhythm, of course. Key signature, we talked about high and low. Lyrics, and what kind of lyrics? What kind of consonants are we using? What kinds of consonants and vowels are we using in those songs? They have a tremendous effect on how the brain receives and how the body receives the music, especially when we're dealing with fragile people. So, we have this music coming in and affecting the whole body. Anyone has seen the YouTube of Henry, about the 93-year-old black guy lost in dementia, hasn't had his head up, isn't smiling, and all of a sudden, he listens to his own era of music, jazz from the 20s. He perks up. He not only knows the melodies and the rhythm, but he remembers the words. I have the privilege of seeing this all the time. Perhaps you have seen a relative or a friend react to familiar music, a person who is lost in dementia. You will recall also that Gabby Giffords, the senator from Arizona who was shot in the head, used therapeutic music to get well. I have seen my stroke victims who cannot speak sing their needs. So we've got Music for healing. Music for recovery and remembering. Music for the relief of pain, anxiety, depression, and music for dying and grieving. This isn't anything new. You'll recall in the Old Testament the story of King Saul, who was filled with demons. And David came in with his harp and cast out the evil spirits. And Plato had this wonderful quote. He says, "Music is soul to the universe, wings to the mind, flight to the imagination, and life to everything." So, what do I do? Let me introduce you to my patient, Helen, who I can hear all the way down the hospital floor, cussing up a stream. "Will somebody get the hell in here?" I was directed to her room and warned about the cussing. She had chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder, COPD, where the heart and the respirations, she was just breathing frantically. When I entered the room, she was pasting white from lack of oxygen, her respirations and sweating profusely just from the simple act of trying to remove the sweater. So I used some of my training and I decided, okay, here's a time for the entraining principle, which states the human body will in fact respond to an external rhythm prompt or a beat. Let me demonstrate. So I began at Helen's respiration rate and slowly began to bring it down to 60 to 100 beats per minute, which is normal resting heartbeat. Here's what we do. Rock my soul in the bosom of Abraham, rock my soul in the bosom of Abraham, rock my soul in the bosom of Abraham, oh, rock my soul. So high, you can't get over it, so low, you can't get under it, so wide, you can't get round it, oh, rock my soul. Well, you can feel that beat coming down. Now, I did that over about a minute with you, but I did it over about 10 minutes with Helen, because we know that it takes about 10 to 12 minutes for the body to respond to music. Sometimes longer. So Helen's respirations calmed to a resting heartbeat. She began to breathe more beautifully and rhythmically. Her complexion pinked up, I like to call it pinked up. She wasn't pasty anymore. And of course, first thing she says, "Who the hell are you?" And I said, "I am who I am," gave my protocol. And she said, "Well, you can come to my room anytime you want to." And I did for the next 2 years until she died peacefully of her disease. I'd like to end with a personal story. 2.5 years ago, I broke both wrist bones. Now, I'm a writer. I'm a musician. I'm a teacher. Both wrist bones gone. And then while still in a cast at a family reunion with the grandkids, I fell and shattered my shoulder and my humerus. I required huge surgery and opioid pain medications, of course. Knowing how addictive they are, learning all the press about what opioids can do, I took half the dosage recommended, and I took it for less time than recommended. And when I felt I didn't need the pain medications anymore, I took them away. First, I had a panic attack. Then I became so claustrophobic, I wanted to rip the cast off my arm. I was sweating. I was shaking. I felt like things were crawling on me. I was having mood swings, paranoia, diarrhea, and sometimes suicidal thinking. So I called the orthopedic practice and said what I was having. And they said the doctor would get back to me. It took 2 days. And a doctor did not get back to me, but a receptionist got back to me and said, well, we don't do drug withdrawal. You go to your own doctor for that. And anyway, how long have you been on the pain meds? I said, 2 weeks. Oh, you can't get addicted in that time. So I called my regular doctor and went to her, and she called what I was going through major medical withdrawal, complete with heart arrhythmia, an opportunity for heart attack and heart failure. She described what we would do together and meted out a small amount of drugs over a long, protracted period of time for me to wean off carefully. You know, I went back on me. And I had the benefit of walking and swimming, being in nature. I had a quiet house. I had a supportive spouse who was making delicious meals. I drank water. And I had a really amazing advantage. I also had music. I suited up every single day with headphones and my pre-recorded music, the kind that I play for my patients, low, beautiful, harmonious, easy music. I suited up and I rested and I cried. I calmed, I slept, and I got better. But I had all the advantages. And I had music like this. Have already occurred in 2017 in this country for opioid misuse and withdrawal and overuse. That's double the amount in 10 years. And we're only in November. We can make things better with less drugs and more music.